We'll start with our Android basic demo classes. So today we'll be talking about like what is the Android operating system and what is the architecture of Android operating system. Okay. So before we start, I'm guessing that you might be having a little bit basic knowledge on Java, because if we want to develop any application for Android, Java would be the programming basic programming language. Okay, so on a scale of 1 to 10, means how much Java are you comfortable with?
Right, if I have the Java as of now, I'm say zero because I've not start preparing anything. But ultimately, yes, if you're going to start, so because on the previous side, I will start preparing the Java to come out that
Okay. Okay, so pretty much Java is a must. So we should know at least core Java, not the complete part, but you should know at least the core Java, because otherwise when I'll teach you the things, right, like classes and how Android works, it will be a difficult one to grab on. I'm not saying it will be very impossible part, but it will be very difficult to understand both things at the same time. Okay, so just give me a second. Yeah. Can see my screen, right?
Yeah, I can.
Okay. So we'll start with the history of Android. Okay. Android was founded by actually Andy Robin, and later it became the part of a Open Handset Alliance. Okay, when I say Open Handset Alliance, means now Android is not being owned by a single guy or a single company. It is a part of a Handset Alliance, means organizations, lots of organizations, they collaborated with each other to develop the future of this operating system. That means it is not going to be shared, the profit which is going to be coming from selling the applications or developing the platform is not going to be owned by a particular organization. They have their own right to sell it, and they have their own right to take the profit. So why is it like that? Because it is purely based on open source platform, that is Linux kernel. Okay, so Linux, because Linux is an open source platform, so Android developed over the Linux is also an open source platform. But still, Google owns the platform APIs to, for the developers. Okay. And it is also free of cost. Okay. Okay. So Google has its own framework APIs, which he will provide for you for the developers to develop Android applications over the existing Android operating system. Okay. So when I talk about this APIs, right, these are the Java frameworks, Java developed frameworks, which we use actually to develop our applications to interact with the base Android operating system. Fine. Okay. So now what is Android? It is an open source platform, as I said, and operating system for mobile device. It is based on Linux kernel. It is developed by Google, and later the Open Handset Alliance allows writing managed code in Java language. Okay. Now, one very important thing. If you heard about JVM in Java, Java has its Java virtual machine for execution of code into bit byte codes. Okay. So the same way it works with the Android as well, but it has its own means executioner compiler that is called Dalvik virtual machine. And this Dalvik virtual machine is actually much lighter than that Java virtual machine in perspective of resources utilization, battery utilization, and memory utilization. So because mobile devices have limited resources, these three things, so the compiler also has to be changed. So they developed a new compiler for that, that is Dalvik virtual machine. Okay. Okay, so now, as I told you about the Open Handset Alliance, right? So what it is Open Handset Alliance is a business alliance of firms to develop open standard for mobile devices. Okay, so they have made a collaboration to develop the mobile platform, and not just to own, not just for a particular person to own the platform. Okay, and for this thing, the technologies which is being used for the development are being taken care by the Google, and the devices and the hardware are being taken care by some other companies like LG, HTC, as you know, Samsung, Motorola. All these have their own Open Handset Alliance services over the Android platform. Okay. Hello.
Yeah.
So now we'll talk about the versions of the Android. Okay. So Android basically started with the 1.0, then 1.5, then 1.6. Okay. But until this 2.3 or 2.0, right? There was no actual phone actually available in the market to support this Android platform for mobiles. Okay. After 2.3, T-Mobile started their first Android platform operating system phone to support the Gingerbread into the mobile phones. Okay. So after that, sorry.
Can you remember that? What is that? 2.2.
That is the versions of Android.
No, Gingerbread. You said on some difference.
Yeah, until 2.3, right, there was no actual mobile phone which was running Android operating system, I was telling. Okay. So T-Mobile, there is a company called T-Mobile. They developed their first Android Android phone running the Android operating system. Okay. After that, Google has evolved the Android operating system from 2.3 to 3.0 to 4.0 to 4.1, then 5. Now it is running 6.0. So continuous evolution of technology is being taken care by Google. Complete API framework and complete application packaging, everything from creating the application to deploying the application. So we have a Play Store which is being owned by Google, right? So they provide a developer certificate so that anyone can actually develop and upload any application over the Play Store. Fine?
It is all free of cost, right? So whoever can develop and you can put the data.
Exactly. Vice versa. But for developer, it is a $25 one-time investment is there for the lifetime. You have to purchase a developer certificate, that is $25, that will cost you, and it is for lifetime. You don't have to renew it. Okay. Okay, so these are the means version and when they came. The first version came in 2008, then the second one came in 2009, third one again came in 2009, fourth again came in 2009. So likewise, these are the date interval where when the versions are got released. Okay, and upcoming versions, it is like it is already being launched actually, KitKat, and 5.0 is now named as not Key Lime Pie, it is Lollipop, then Marshmallow. So these are the versions like what Android supports currently. Now we'll talk about the Android architecture. Okay, so Android, by saying Android architecture, I'm saying Android OS architecture, not the application architecture. Okay, so Android OS architecture is divided into the four layers: application layer, application framework layer, libraries and the runtime, and the kernel. Okay, I'll show you this thing in a diagram. You'll understand better. Okay, so application layer. What is the application layer is, it consists of home, contacts, phone, browser. So these are the things which you actually see on your Android phone when you open your phone. So in Android phone, everything is an application actually. When you start your phone, the screen which comes, that is also an application. Okay, so that home screen, right, which you see is also an application, and when you click on something over there, it will take you to the another application like contacts, phone, browser. Okay, these are the basic application which you will get when you install an Android operating system on your phone by default. So these are the base layer of the application which all the developers will use also as a service providers to get any sort of service if you require. Okay, if you want your in your application that a user should be able to browse the data, means internet, so you need that browser services. Exactly. Am I audible?
Yeah, I'm audible. I'm listening. Have the query. Okay, complete this, then I will have the query.
Okay, fine. Then the other one is contacts, then phone. In contacts, if you want to access users' contact inside your application, then you have to take the service from the contacts. Likewise, from the phone, if you want to get the call logs, so you will have to access the services of that application phone. Okay, and now how you will be able to access the services is comes under the second layer, that is called the application framework layer. Okay, in the application framework layer, there are some managers or utility managers which provide these utilities like services which I was talking about to the developers for the utilization of their inside their applications. Okay, now what is activity manager? So let me tell you first something like what is activity. Okay, inside phone, whatever screen which you see, right, first screen holding any data or holding any widgets, that is actually an activity. An activity is nothing but a Java class which is extending the base activity as means a parent activity. Okay, when you say and create any class, say home, and extend activity, okay, you'll get some overridden method there, and that class, complete class, will be called as a activity. Okay, so when you're developing an application, you will have multiple activities. So handling these multiple activities, when to show which activity, is being done by activity manager. Okay, you can take activity as a view itself. You have multiple views and you want to show which view right now and which view later is being handled by activity manager. Okay, the second thing is window manager. When you have a view, where you will put that view? That view will be always be inside a window, right? Phone window, where we are setting all the views. So that holding the view and showing the view is being handled by the window manager. Fine. Then content providers. So just now which I told you, right? If we want to use some services of browser, phone, and basic phone services, we have to get the permission from. I'm sorry. We have to get the permission from them and access it. So that handling of permission and getting the data is being done by content providers. Okay, they provide you a URL or a URI, I will say, where you can access the certain part of the database of other application. You cannot access the complete application because of the sandboxing layer concept of Android. Okay, so that is why content provider is required for getting data from any outside application to your application.
Okay,
now the view system. What is the view system is? View system is anything which is binding all the elements or the widgets of the Android inside your scalable window. Okay, when I say scalable window, you might have seen that Android supports multiple range of screen sizes, right? 5-inch, 4-inch, 7-inch, 10-inch, right? So according to that, the view system also get increased or decreased. So holding that screen size according to the widgets and your layouts is being done by the view system. Fine. Next one is package manager. Package Manager is actually very important application framework here, because it handles actually the identity of your particular application. Okay, so you have lots of application inside your phone. Okay, how you are going to identify means differentiate between one application to another application, it will be done by the Package Manager. Because when you define the package, right, package name for your application, it has to be unique, so that when you upload in the Play Store or when you want to differentiate between with some other application with your application, it has to be defined unique. Fine. Because when we are when we are trying to send some data also, like what I told in content provider, from one application to another application, package manager will be checking out that which package is trying to access the data of which package. So from package only, they decide the application ID of the whole application. Okay, so it has to be unique, and it has to be it has to be different from each and other application, so that you can so that package manager can actually decide like which application ID is trying to access the data. Fine. Okay, then telephony manager. So telephony manager is basically used for all the telephony calls or activities like that. Okay, and like if you want to make a call, if you want to get the contacts data, so you use the telephony manager for getting those services. Hello. Hello.
Sorry, go ahead.
Okay. Fine. Are you ready now?
Yeah.
Yeah, fine. Then resource manager. So as I told you just few times before, that Android has lots of screen sizes. Okay. So if you want to show some images according to your design pattern, if you have to show some images or something which will be differing from the screen sizes, like for 4-inch screen size you want to show this small image, in the bigger screen size you want to show big image, right? Because you cannot show the same density pixel image for all the screen sizes, it will distort your on the screen, right? So if you want to do that, you have to give separate images inside your application structure, okay, package structure. And resource manager will take care of, like, according to screen size, it will take care like which screen size, which image should get displayed over there. Fine. Okay. The next thing will be location manager. So location manager is being used for providing the user's location and geological services, all sort of geological services like maps and lat routes and anything related to current location, user's location, is being handled by the location manager. Fine. Then notification manager. So notification manager is basically used by the developers for giving users notifications, like if you are running some task which user has to be notified that this task has been completed and you got a new message or something, then you have to notify the user, right? So where we will use the notification manager for notifying users about any particular event. Okay, fine.
Yeah.
Okay, the next thing will be the libraries. So these are the libraries which are being written in actually C programming language. Okay, so we don't actually directly interact with them. We use our middle framework, application framework, to interact with the libraries. Okay, so these are the JNIs in the application framework, are the written JNIs which will actually interact with the C code to for us to get the direct access of this fourth layer, that is Linux kernel. Okay, so if you want to directly interact with the hardware, you cannot do that. You have to go through the libraries which are being developed using our application framework. Okay, so you can access the camera data or Bluetooth data or power data, Wi-Fi data, anything. If you want to access, you have to go through the application framework, then libraries, then kernel, Linux kernel. You cannot directly access the hardware. That's the whole point of developing this architecture. Fine. So when I say this thing, Linux kernel, we have these functionalities like display driver, camera driver, flash driver, okay, keypad driver, Wi-Fi driver, audio driver, power management. So these are the basic functionalities which all the hardware will have, because it has to run an operating system, right? There is one more thing is called binder IPC driver. Okay, what is binder IPC driver is, it is the driver which allows you to do the multitasking inside an Android. When I say multitasking, I mean working in different threads at the same time. Okay, so IPC means inter-process communication. Okay, so if you are working in multiple threads at the same time, you have to communicate between the threads also. So when to start the other thread, when to stop this thread, and prioritizing of the thread. Okay, so that is being done by the binder IPC. Okay, and the other thing is, now at the last is Android runtime. Okay, so what Android runtime do is, Android runtimes collaborate all these functionalities into the core libraries. Okay, and core libraries are the things which is going to be run over the Dalvik virtual machine, that is the compiler of Android, which will compile the Java classes into the bytecodes, and then bytecode into the packageable executable file, that is called APK, which we will run on our Android phones. Okay, so the system is like, you develop in Java, it will get converted into bytecode, bytecode will get converted into executable file, that is called APK, and that way you will install in your phones. Fine. So what brief description which I did right in the last page, that's what is being written here. The architecture is based on Linux 2.6 kernel. Layer is core of Android architecture. Okay, this service, it provides service like power management, memory management, and security purpose. Okay, so because it is the kernel layer, it has to provide all the Linux functionalities which are there, okay, but in a limited resources, because this is for mobile devices. So it helps in software or hardware binding for better communication. So this is the one which will bind the software and hardware, because these are the drivers which will interact with the actual boards, hardware boards, and then provide the data to the libraries, and then libraries will provide the data to the application framework. Okay, so Android has its own libraries which is written in C, C++. These libraries cannot be accessed directly. With the help of application framework, we can access these libraries. There are many libraries like web libraries to access web browser, libraries for Android and video formats, etc. Fine, right? That's what I told, right? These are the basic functionalities only, which is written in C, C++, but we cannot directly access them. We have to use our application framework to access them. When I say basic functionalities, it has database, web browsing, surface manager, media frameworks like audio, video, every type, free types, means what all open source functionalities are there. OpenGL and ES means rendering of the views over the surface, that is graphical designing, and some other functionalities which we are not even bothered about right now. So Android runtime was designed specifically for Android to meet the needs of running in an embedded environment where you have limited battery, limited memory, limited CPU. So Dalvik is the process virtual machine in Google's Android operating system. It is the software that runs the apps on Android devices. Dalvik is thus an integral part of Android, which is typically used on mobile devices such as mobile phones and tablet computers. Programs are commonly written in Java and compiled to bytecode. And those bytecodes are being converted into executable files for them to run. Hello?
Yeah, I'm
okay. Yeah, so core libraries contains all of the collections, classes, utility classes, and utility tools, which I told you, which are being then sent to Dalvik virtual machine compiler to get converted into bytecodes. That is the whole functionality of the Android runtime. Then it is telling you about means what is the application framework, what application framework do, and who provides it. It includes application written by Google and it includes apps that will be written by you. Okay, so application framework basically contains all the APIs and applications which are being developed by actually Google. So this application framework is actually being provided by Google, and we use their services to develop our applications. Okay, and there is a brief description about everything which I told you, like what activity manager do, what resource manager do, what notification manager do, what location manager do. All those things which I told you, right, has been written up briefly here.
Yeah, right.
Okay, now the top layer also contains the same things which I told you, that home, browser, all those things, all the application like camera, Google Maps, browser, SMS, calendar, contacts, and native application. These application works with the end user with the help of application framework to operate. Okay, now security purpose, Android is multi-process system in which each application runs on its own process. Most security between application and the system is enforced at the process level through standard Linux facilities such as user and group IDs that are assigned to application. Okay, so now this is what I was talking about, the security thing. If you have multiple applications running, right, so how the security will be handled, like how we are going to know that this user or this data belongs to this application, or this user, this data belongs to the other application. So they have mentioned as term group IDs in our Android. That group IDs are actually nothing but application IDs, okay, which I told you in package manager. So when you define a package, it will generate an application ID for that particular application with a unique package name. So from that package ID, application ID, is what Android is going to decide like which application is different from other application. Okay. So Android is designed for multi-layer securities which provide flexibility for this platform. When attackers attempt to attack on device, Android platform help to reduce the portability of the attack. Okay, just now I told you, right, Android platform has a sandboxing concept. Okay, by sandboxing I mean the means data of one application cannot be directly accessed from another application. It is being secured. If you want to access it, you have to take the permission from the ad application that you want to access this particular amount of data. Then also, when you try to access that, it will have its own database. Means every application has its own SQLite database, but it will not give you the access to the direct SQLite database. It will give you access through using content provider to the particular amount of data which you want. Okay? Hello?
Yeah, your voice.
Oh, is it? Now is it better?
Yeah.
Okay. What I was telling is, we cannot directly access the data of another application, database of another application. You have to ask the permission from that application. Using content provider, you can use the data, but limited data which the other application is been providing you.
Okay.
Other features like design review, code review, penetration testing, open source and community review, incident response. Okay, so these are some other features of Android. Like when you are working with the open source platform, right, you definitely will have communities, lots of communities which are joining for helping, and if you have any queries for them, they will respond to you. So you'll get lots of help if you got stuck somewhere, because it is widely being developed and widely used language Java, and widely being used platform also. So whenever you'll have any issue, you can post your issues on the communities and you'll get an incident response. Okay, and design reviews, you can ask. There are actually few good websites are there where you can actually review your designing concepts and your coding concepts. And for testing also, there are websites where you can actually send your code for testing, and they'll test you. Even the Google do that, and if you'll provide the code to them, they'll review the code and they'll test it, and then they will return back you. Okay. So actually, before uploading it to the Play Store, also Google reviews the package and your code. Okay, but not at the extreme level. Just for the malware concepts. Like there should not be any malware or any viruses. Okay. So there are some features of Android, like it provides you the logging and analyzing of the applications. It is optimized for mobile devices. It enables reuse and replacements of components. Like I told you, right? You can use one activity over another activity, then use back the first activity. So that is called the activity lifecycle, which we will discuss later. So how it handles activity concepts and how it handles the components and reusability of the components. So Java supports multitasking, voice-based features, screen capture, camera, Bluetooth, which almost all Android phone supports now. The ability for anyone to customize the Google Android platform is the biggest advantage of an Android application or Android operating system. So when we talk about this thing to customize, you can actually do anything with your Android phone, Android operating system. You can actually write your own operating system as well, because the code is completely open source and it is being available on the market. So by saying this customization, if you compare it with iPhones, you cannot get the codes there. Okay, you cannot get the any services from there. Means operating system based. So you cannot tweak into that thing, or you cannot change anything there. But accordingly, you can do the same with the Google Android operating system. So that's what Samsung, Sony, you might have seen other vendors, they do. When Google launches the Android operating system, they customize it according to their need, and they sell their Android phones with a different look and feel from the original made Android operating system, right? Okay, so it gives you better notification. It lets you choose your hardware, means because operating system is customizable, so you can actually customize it according to your hardware, how your hardware being made. So it is a more mature platform. It has better app market, and I'm not talking about just the Google market, Google Play Store market. It has many other Android market, Play Store markets, okay, where you can upload your applications. Actually, with Google Chrome, you can open many windows at once. So these are the basic functionalities which you work in, means which you'll get inside any Android phone using any Android Google based applications. It has Gmail to access the mails. Okay, so disadvantage is very few disadvantages are there. I'll say it's not disadvantage, it is actually a service which is being not used properly. Okay, so just because Google is an open source, anyone can actually mold it according to their need. Developer will face problems in developing the application and meeting the need of all the devices and all the hardware platforms. Okay, if you're designing for one standard platform, it is easy for you, but when you have lots of vendors out there which are developing the Android platform Android operating system according to their hardware needs, so you have to mold your design accordingly so that it should work in all the vendor platforms. Because if you are creating an application, you cannot just create it for one device or one platform, one vendor support. You have to support all the platforms and all the vendors. So that is actually the main disadvantage, or you can say misutilization of service. Okay. Fine. And the other thing is, yeah, it is battery consuming because OS consume OS works on multi-process, right? So it consumes a lot of battery in the background. So drainage of battery is a bigger issue in Android. Sometimes slow device company issued an official version of Android your own. Yeah, that's what I was talking about. Like the one which Google will launch, they will customize it and launch it with their own version, and that will be very slow and will have some issues which are like not compatibility with the Android operating system. So that gives developer a disadvantage in running their application over the phones. And design inconsistency, because everyone is trying to create their own design over the operating system, so it creates inconsistency over the application and the designing structures. Very unstable and often hang or crash just because of it's not being tested and not being stabilized at the starting. Because what they do is, the time Google will launch an Android operating system, they will customize it according to their own need and they will launch it back to the users, their users. So they don't get too much time to stabilize it according to their hardware needs and they'll launch it. So they this will cause problem for the users to who are using them. Okay. Fine. Development requirements. Android application development is purely done on Java. It has an Android SDK which we use, which I told you about the Google APIs, which we use for the development software development purpose. Okay, and either we can do it in Eclipse IDE or we will use our Android Studio, which is the base IDE for Android application development by Google. Okay, and yeah, pretty much this is it.
Hello.
Yeah, pretty much this is it. You have any doubts?
No. So for the course contents, what we have gone for that, I am clear on that.
Okay.
You say talk about framework, right? So in Java, in Android, have the multiple frameworks app development, right? As my understand from the market, so Android app can be developed in multiple frameworks, right? Is it?
Multiple frameworks. What do you mean by frameworks?
Like say I came across now Ionic framework, somebody explained Ionic framework and Angular. So these all the things I heard from the market.
Okay.
So now which we are going for learning only for the SDK, or we are going to learn for the other frameworks, how we are going to use those things?
Okay. I think you are talking about cross-platform dependencies where you develop in JavaScript HTML, if I am not wrong, please correct me, JavaScript HTMLs and port it in Android, iOS and Windows, all those things. I think Ionic framework works for that thing. And what we are trying to do here is, we are trying to make a native Android application which will work only for Android, not for iOS, and which will be developed for Java.
Okay.
Am I right? That's what you're trying to ask?
Yeah, right. So
okay.
That's we are going to learn only on Android platforms, on the Android native platforms, right?
Yeah, Android native platforms only.
Okay. So what is the difference between this Android native platform and this, if say, Ionic framework, the multiple platform frameworks? What is much different in this, as you said?
Yes, it is actually a lot different. I'll tell you the basic basic difference. One is, in the Ionic framework also we will use Java code, but on a limited range. just to launch our application. It is a kind of a web app which you are developing in a Ionic framework, which will only work inside a web view, you can say. It will launch as an application for you, but it will work as a web view. All the application coding and every functionality will be written in HTML, JavaScript, jQuery. Okay, and for reusability purpose, this is being done like that, so that you don't have to rewrite the whole code in Android and iPhone differently. You just need to launch that using your WebView, which WebKit I told you, right? In the application framework, we have a WebKit. So using that, they launch their application, and the control will go to the web part from there. It won't be there in the native. So that it is dependency is being reduced, like it doesn't have to be recoded according to the operating system. WebKit is there in all the operating system. Okay, but the disadvantage is just a second. Here, see, right? You have an application framework, right? You have this four-layer framework. When you do this Ionic framework things, right? You add another framework here. In between, I'll show you, in between this libraries and application framework, you add another framework layer, which is your Ionic framework layer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what you are doing is you are creating another delay between the execution of hardware and user.
Mm-hmm.
So that makes your application actually slow as well as unreliable. So if you are going to develop an intense platform, right, means a service intense platform where you have to provide services to many people and intense services, not just showing viewing device screens, something like that. If you have something which hardware layer programming, means you want to get some software location data, Bluetooth data or something like that, which is related to hardware, then this application is not going to perform as well as what a native will do. So that is a bigger difference. It's easy to code. It's easy to code and it's easy to port, but when it comes to performance, it is not that good as what an Android native application will be.
So once we go through this process and we say I've studied this entire process, I'm able to develop my app on this technology. So this Ionic framework, as the activities wise, how much is it different between, because nowadays, okay, say current Android, but there are people who want to be a published iOS app too. So we need the technology to be incorporated. So that's how the activities have been different between this technology and that frameworks.
Technology is completely different. There you will code in the HTML, JavaScript and jQuery, Ajax, okay, Node.js you have to use for your designing purpose as well. So I will say your Java coding will be useful there as well, but at a very minimum level, because you are mostly will be coding on the HTML platform. So when you want to port it in Java, Android, your Java coding will be useful. In iOS, you have to learn Objective-C as well for porting.
Okay.
So that much useful it will be, like it will help you how it, you will know at least like how to port an application then.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. And now currently what we are going to learn for this Java, is it the which version of the Java, or what type of the knowledge I should have if I want to be sticking this class to be further. So may, if I want to prepare some Java course, Java material, so what are the things I need to prepare in Java? So that may help me to understand this app development very fast.
Okay, so you should be, for, I won't say version, but core Java platform, right? Core Java you should learn, and basic OOP concepts you should learn. that will be good enough for you to understand the Android application development lifecycle.
Okay.
So when I say core Java, abstraction, encapsulation, okay, polymorphism, fine, interface, these things you should be very well aware of. Classes, how classes works, how object creation works. So if you will be aware of these things, it will be easy for you to grab on.
Okay. Right.
Hello?
Yeah, 1 second. Just okay. So how many apps do you so far develop as a practical experience?
How many I have created, you are saying?
Yeah.
More than 6 to 7 apps I have actually uploaded on the Play Stores, I have developed more than 15 to 20 applications, which are for corporate peoples. So mostly few of them, they don't upload to the Play Store. They use it for their in-house purpose.
Okay, so all of the apps are in the same technology or same platforms, right?
Android, you are saying?
No, Android is the same native SDK, SDK to use for the SDK?
I have developed in cross-platform as well. But I haven't used Ioni framework, I have used PhoneGap for that.
PhoneGap, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You told right, some websites have been free websites is there for the testing the apps for there's a testing the apps mean the initial testing the app, right? You mean to say when I'm developing that app, so I can load it and I can check my code reviews and those things I can do, right?
Code reviews you can do.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'm cool now. I'm through the subject now. So, what are the course concerns? Means we're going to study. Can you get that information? So, what we are going to teach and
I actually have a course content. I'll ask Sunny and I'll share it with you.
Yeah, just maybe help me to go through that.
Yeah, I'll share with you. I'll just ask Sunny and I'll share that.
Sure. Okay, so the course material, what are the materials we are going to provide?
Okay, soft material you want or like what? We have actually a developer site, we will follow that more, more than any other content. developer.android.com, they have the list of APIs. We will, for theory purpose, we will go there and we will see, and mostly it will be a hands-on practice here.
Okay, so that's mean the all the materials, generally you won't provide the materials, we will browse it in the net, and so practical, I can come down and you can say here I can learn all the practicals, right?
Exactly. And the recordings, I think this software provides a recording of the session, so that you can take as a reference when you want to develop on your own.
Okay. What else? So you will be on the flexible on this timing from 7:30 to 8:30 regularly.
Not actually regularly, I cannot be flexible with this timing. Actually, there is one more person who is actually willing to be on this time, but even I'm a working guy, so daily this timing won't be possible. Weekdays, on weekdays, 1 or 2 days I can do this time. Other than that, on weekends we can have actually any time, right?
Okay.
Because
because we work for Saturdays also.
You work.
I work for Saturday also. That's what. So generally, what time to what time you will be available in office, and what is your free time? So then we can plan it out.
Yeah, generally my working hours are 10 to 7. You can say like half hour, 1 hour for traveling also, going there and coming back.
Okay.
So that's why it is tight for me to, means can't woke up in the morning.